Sæl og verið velkomin í íslensku fyrir útlendinga. Hi and welcome to this episode of Icelandic for Foreigners. Today we're going to be talking about the dreaded topic of Icelandic cases. Now, Icelandic cases are considered one of the most difficult concepts in the language. So today I'm hoping to just simplify it a little bit for you, give you an overview so that when you move forward you can feel a little bit more confident in what you're doing. Now, cases, these go by other names, so you might hear this concept referred to in any one of these ways. You may hear it referred to as inflection, as nouns or adjectives or pronouns inflecting. You might also hear declension, or a noun declining. You might also hear bending, which comes from the Icelandic name for it. So you might hear that nouns or words are bending. And the last one, this is the Icelandic word, fallbeyging, is how you may hear it referred to. Now, all of these are referring to the same idea. And that idea is that words can take one of many forms depending on their function in the sentence. So I'm going to go over the names of the cases real quick. And this won't mean a lot to you yet unless you already know your way around the cases a little bit. There are four cases. There is nominative, accusative, dative, and genitive. Four word forms, one for each of these cases. Now, if you're looking at this and wondering, I have no idea what any of those words mean, that's okay. Unless you speak Latin, then these words aren't going to mean much to you. Even now, they don't mean much to me, even though I know what they're referring to. So don't think that accusative has anything to do with accusing somebody. Don't think that dative has anything to do with data. There's really no connection. These words are basically arbitrary. The Icelandic names for each of these are nefnifall, þolfall, þágufall, and eignarfall. Don't worry too much about knowing those. Okay, so here's an example of a word in its different cases. This is the word for dog, hundur. That top form, the nominative form, is what you'll see in the dictionary. The other words are forms of that word in each of the cases. So there are four forms for the word dog. Hundur, hund, hundi, and hund. So you're looking at that and you're thinking, why? Why are there four words? And that's what this video is about. So the question is, when do we use each one? Why are they different? So in order to do that, first we need to get a little bit of grammar background. We need to learn about the parts of a sentence, specifically the subject and the object. So let's look at the subject first. The subject is a noun or a pronoun. If you don't know what a noun or a pronoun is, I recommend looking somewhere on YouTube to find out what a noun or a pronoun is, but basically it's referring to a person, place, or thing, or an idea, right? So the subject is the noun or pronoun that does the action, that does the verb. So usually you can tell what it is because it comes right before the verb, although not always. But this is when you ask the question, what is doing it? What is doing the verb? So here are some examples. The boy saw the dog. Who's doing the seeing? It's the boy. The boy is the subject. She ate the sandwich. Who ate it? Who ate the sandwich? It was she. She's doing the eating, so she is the subject. It is cold. What is cold? What's doing the being? It. We don't know what that's referring to, but we know that it is the subject. Next, we're going to learn about the object of the sentence. The object is also a noun or a pronoun. But this is the noun or pronoun that experiences the verb, so it usually comes after the verb. Or it experiences a preposition, comes after a preposition. We'll talk a little bit more about that. So the first one, the object of the verb, this is what's experiencing the verb. So in the sentence, the boy saw the dog, the boy is the subject, it's doing the seeing. But what is being seen? It's the dog. The dog is the object of the sentence. The girl ate it. What did she eat? It. It was what was eaten. I can't remember his name. So I is the subject because it's doing the remembering. His name is what is being remembered. His name is the object of the verb. Now there's also the object of the preposition. In case you're having a hard time remembering what a preposition is, it's anything that shows the relation to a noun. Now I can't really spend that much time in this video talking about what a preposition is. Go on YouTube and find any number of videos that tells you what a preposition is. Now, prepositions can also have an object. It's the noun or pronoun that comes directly after the preposition. So in the sentence, the boy is under the table, under is the preposition. The table is the object of the preposition. What is the boy under? The table. The girl ran around it. Around is the preposition, and it is the object of the preposition. He slept through the meeting. Through is the preposition, and the meeting is the object of the preposition. So here are a couple more examples for subject and object. The boy saw the dog. The boy is doing the seeing, so it's going to be the subject. The dog is what's being seen, so it is the object of the verb. The boy sent the girl the letter. Who's doing the sending? The boy. What is being sent? The letter to the girl. So those are both objects. Sent the girl the letter. They're both experiencing the verb. Girl is actually the indirect object and letter is the direct object, which just means that the girl is receiving the action and the letter is what the action is being done to. But they're both objects. The boy sent the girl the letter on Tuesday. So the same subject, the same two objects, but we have another object, on Tuesday. On is a preposition, and Tuesday is the object of that preposition. I know it feels like I'm going through this part really fast, and that's just because this is more basic English grammar, so if you need to review that, there are probably other places that you can learn that a little bit better. I want to get to the Icelandic part. So now that we've talked about subjects and objects, the question is, how does this relate to cases? And this is quite simple, actually. The subjects of the sentence are in the nominative case, in the dictionary form, the one that we saw at the very top, the nominative form. The objects of the sentence are in one of the three other cases. So let's talk first about nominative. The subjects of the sentence are in nominative. Whatever is doing the action is going to be in nominative. Now, there are a couple things that you have to watch out for, and the first is this does not apply to nouns that come after the verbs vera, verda, and heita, which mean to become, and to be called. In this case, both nouns are going to be in nominative. So if you say, jeg maður, I am a man, jeg and maður are both the subjects, they're both nominative. You know that that's true because you can reverse it and say, maður jeg, a man am I, and it still means the same thing. So watch out for that. The next thing to watch out for is there are a few of what are called impersonal verbs. These are very strange. I'll be going over them in great detail in a different video. But there are a couple different kinds of sentences where the subject is not in nominative. Here are the four you need to watch out for. Langar, finst, vantar, and tekir. But we'll talk about that in a later video. Just know that occasionally there is a different case that acts as the subject, but it's primarily only seen with these four verbs. These are the big ones. Okay, so the objects of any sentence are going to be in one of the other cases. So the question is, which case? Which of the three remaining cases do we use for the object? The answer is either the verb will tell you or the preposition will tell you. And what I mean by that is when you look the verb up in the dictionary, it will tell you which case its object should be in. And the same with the preposition. And we describe that as the verb governing a certain case or the preposition governing a certain case. So let's take a look at some examples. The verb al siao, which means to see. When you look it up in the dictionary, it'll have acc written next to it, which means accusative, which means whatever is being seen in your sentence is going to be an accusative. Same with ad elska, to love. Whatever is being loved in your sentence is going to be an accusative. So let's look at two sentence examples. Þeir sjá konuna, they see the woman. The woman is in accusative because sjá always governs accusative. Þeir elska konuna, again, konuna is an accusative because the object of elska is always an accusative. The next one, að hjálpa, which means to help, always takes dative after. So whatever the object of help is, whether it's your mom or the world or your grandmother, whatever that is going to be in dative. So þeir hjálpa konunni, that's the dative form. They help the woman. The word sakna, which means to miss a person, is always in genitive. Whatever is being missed, if you miss your family or you miss your boyfriend, it's always going to be in genitive. Þeir sakna konunnar. That's the genitive form. So the verb will tell you which case should come after it. Now, there are a couple verbs that will have two cases, and that just means that the verb takes two objects or can take two objects. For example, senta, to send, you can send someone something. So whatever, it is that you're sending, whether it's a letter or an email, is going to be an accusative, and whoever you're sending it to, your mom, your grandma, will be in dative. So here's an example. Mamma min sentimier brev. My mom, the subject, sentimier, sent me, dative, brev, accusative, a letter. The same thing goes for säga, to say. You can say something to someone or say someone something. And geva, to give. So whatever you're giving, whether it's a present or advice, is going to be an accusative. And whoever you're giving it to is going to be in dative. So occasionally you'll see in the dictionary a verb with two cases after, and that means that it can take two objects. All right, so that's enough for objects of the verb. The preposition, when there's an object of the preposition will tell you which case to use. So for example, after the prepositions which means about, ikeknum, through, ikrinkum, around, you always have accusative after. So professorin talar Island. The professor talks about Iceland. Is the preposition and Island is the object, and always has accusative after. So Island is the accusative form of Iceland. The professor talks about Iceland. Some prepositions always take dative, like frau, which means from, av, off of, hjau, near, and ausamt, along with. So in the sentence, han er frau Islandi, he is from Iceland. Islandi is the dative form because it follows frau, it's the object of frau. And genitive, the prepositions til, which means to, aun, which means without, and mittli, which means between, always take genitive after. Við förum til Íslands. We go to Iceland. Iceland is the subject of to, and it's in genitive. Now, there are a couple prepositions that can require accusative or dative after, depending on the meaning. I'll be going into this in greater depth in a different video, so stay posted for that. All right, the last thing that you need to know about cases for the sake of this video is the genitive case is also used for possession. So, bok brother means, where brother means is in genitive, means the book of my brother or my brother's book. Fáni Íslands means the flag of Iceland or Iceland's flag. And backpoki Stefáns means the backpack of Stefán or Stefán's backpack. So here are my tips for practicing. First of all, when you learn a new Icelandic verb or preposition, find out which case it governs. Some verbs won't govern a case, but if it's a verb that can take an object, then there will be a case that would come after it for the object of that verb or that preposition. My second tip is, when you're speaking or reading English, start identifying the subjects and the objects of the sentence. Who is doing the action, or what is doing the action, and then what is the action being done to? Because as you start separating these out in your mind, the doer and then the recipients of the action, you'll be able to start realizing when you need to use nominative in Icelandic and when you need to use one of the other cases. And then the last tip, and this is a big one, start learning the noun and pronoun forms. Now, if you've seen any of the charts for the words, then you know that there are a lot of forms, so don't get overwhelmed. I'll talk about this more in future videos, how to best approach this, but at least start looking for those different forms and starting to recognize them if you can. Don't worry, there will be more videos to come that explain these different cases better and explain how to construct sentences with them. If you have any questions, please feel free to leave a comment below and I'll try and get back to it. If you have any questions that you'd like to see made into videos, then go ahead and let me know. I can't guarantee I'll get to it, but I'll try my best. Please don't forget to like and subscribe and stay tuned for more grammar videos in the future. Bless, bless.